So I'll be talking about esophageal cancer, and from a global perspective, it is the eighth most common cancer worldwide. 90% of esophageal cancer is esophageal squamous cell carcinoma, and if you want the raw numbers, approximately 500,000 new cases arise every year. The red and blue bars refer to new cases and deaths, and you see the two are almost identical in this cancer, reflecting the very high mortality related to it. The darker blue areas reflect the areas with the highest incidence rates, and these high incidence rates cover the so-called esophageal cancer belt through Iran, Russia, China. The reasons for this high incidence is not completely worked out, but it's likely due to environmental exposures. Since I'm not going to be talking about esophageal squamous cell carcinoma, I think it's important to give it due respect. It is the most common type of esophageal cancer, 90% of all cases. It is that cancer that is strongly associated with smoking. It is that cancer that very strongly associated with alcohol intake, 2 or 3 to 5 fold. And the combination of alcohol and smoking has a synergistic effect. And it is that cancer that is predisposed, or the risk is increased in case of achalasia and possibly with HPV infection. I believe our second talk will focus on esophageal squamous cell cancer. So this just is giving you the epi. It's really important globally, and the risk factors belong to the preventable categories. The reason I'm focusing on the other cancer, which is esophageal adenocarcinoma, is that in the United States and several other Western countries, that incidence of esophageal adenocarcinoma has been progressively rising, while that of esophageal squamous cell cancer have been progressively declining, to the degree that esophageal adenocarcinoma has become the dominant form of that cancer in these countries. So here are two examples, United States and Australia. The lines that are going down are squamous. The lines that are going up are esophageal adenocarcinoma. And just a glance about the countries where esophageal adenocarcinoma tends to dominate this scope or this scape of esophageal cancer: UK, Netherlands, US, Denmark, Iceland, Australia, Canada, and go on. So in the United States, apart from the fact that the cancer is rising, there are some peculiar epidemiological findings that I will focus on today, try to describe it and explain it. One of them, this is a white man disease. The incidence in white Caucasians is where most of the increase has been witnessed, as opposed to black females. While there was some increase in the incidence, the actual incidence rates and frequency of cases is quite low. So it's increasing. It's increasing in men, particularly Caucasian men. The three main things that I will discuss is, let's start with reflux. So reflux is a global problem. It is common in the US and several Western countries. It's increasing in some Eastern countries like China, and has been the most consistently linked risk factor to the development of esophageal adenocarcinoma. So for example, the presence of daily symptoms are associated with approximately 8, and in some studies as high as 10-fold increase in the risk of esophageal adenocarcinoma. And having reflux for more than 30 years, particularly reflux that starts at an early age, is associated with several-fold increase in the risk of esophageal adenocarcinoma. So I know we sometimes try to look for additional risk factors, but one should not lose sight that when it comes to risk factors of cancer, reflux is almost as good as it gets. It's consistently linked and highly associated. The problem with it is it's so common. There are too many people with GERD. Of those, few people would have Barrett's esophagus, which is the precancer condition. And fortunately, that is, not unfortunately, very few cases of esophageal adenocarcinoma. So without going into too much details, starting in the US by 150 million people who are older than 50, of those, maybe 20% or so would have reflux. of those, a small proportion would have Barrett's esophagus, and of those, a small number would develop esophageal adenocarcinoma. And hence the additional importance of understanding the risk factors, because it tells you, among the girders, who is more likely to develop esophageal adenocarcinoma. Well, one risk factor that acquired special significance is obesity. Someone came up with this term of globesity, global obesity. The US again leads the way, but it's increasing in several other countries. Older studies have shown that obesity, as indicated by BMI greater than 30, is associated with increased risk of esophageal adenocarcinoma. That's in the bottom graph. Even overweight is associated with some increase in esophageal adenocarcinoma. One of the messages of today's talk is BMI has been linked to the increased risk of almost every cancer that you know of, and almost every entity that you know of, to the degree that its significance as an etiological risk factor is becoming less and less relevant as it's becoming more and more common. It comes to a degree where it's like breathing oxygen. It's very difficult to link that to any condition. So there's a lot of attention to what is proximal to BMI. What does obesity reflect that is injurious that may not be represented by a BMI? There are several studies, and instead of reviewing data, I'm just going to show pictures to show you how obesity is being linked to more precise things like Barrett's esophagus and esophageal adenocarcinoma. So instead of BMI, many studies show that it's really waist hip circumference, but particularly waist, that seems to give you more consistent and stronger association with the risk of Barrett's and esophageal adenocarcinoma. If you dig deeper, then it's not just abdominal obesity, it's visceral abdominal obesity, shown here in green. That is the fat that is active, that works as an inflammatory source and a source of adipokines. If you dig deeper, it's not just the fat, it's what the fat releases. So it works by releasing adipokines and mucking up with the levels of cytokines and insulin IGF pathway, but it also works like a big pad of fat that increases the severity and frequency of reflux. And now there's work to try to link those not to just a big blotch of esophagus called Barrett's esophagus, but perhaps to endophenotypes or global gene expression in those markers. So moving on to a different risk factor, H. pylori infection. This is a slide that shows the prevalence of H. pylori in different countries. I didn't make it up, and it's not from the same source. It just happens to be the completely mirror image or inverse to the slide that I've shown earlier about the risk of esophageal adenocarcinoma. In other words, countries or regions with high H. pylori tend to have low esophageal adenocarcinoma. Now, that is the so-called ecological fallacy. I mean, you could plot Elvis sightings and other things, and it may correlate with this. Therefore, you need studies. So what do the studies show? Rather than showing you multiple studies with number, I chose to summarize the literature. So if you look at GERD symptoms, there have been no consistent association between GERD symptoms and the presence of H. pylori. Almost all the studies are cross-sectional studies, with some longitudinal after eradicating H. pylori. But the jury basically is out, and it shows not linked that much. When it comes to erosive esophagitis, there's been a weak inverse association with H. pylori. When it comes to Barrett's and esophageal adenocarcinoma, there's been a remarkably consistent inverse association between Helicobacter pylori and Barrett's esophagus or esophageal adenocarcinoma. And if you're looking for numbers, the risk is 25 to 50% less. When it comes to esophageal squamous cell carcinoma, although I said I'm not going to talk about it that much, there's been either no association or a slightly positive association. Few other risk factors, one of them is non-steroidal anti-inflammatory that have been studied as possible preventive factors for esophageal adenocarcinoma. And what it shows, the top graph here is never users, the bottom one is current users, the risk of esophageal adenocarcinoma, whether in the setting of known Barrett's or not, is lower among those who use NSAIDs. That's observational data. Interventional data do not really exist to support this contention yet. Smoking, that is the strong risk factor for esophageal squamous cell cancer, is a modest but consistent risk factor for esophageal adenocarcinoma. So these are results from a meta-analysis that shows basically, I'm trying to move this, yes, that shows an increase, 1.40 if it's non-filtered only, higher duration of use, packs of use, they're all in the puny to mildly positive risk factors for esophageal adenocarcinoma and Barrett's esophagus. So if once is said and done, almost 3/4 of all cases of esophageal adenocarcinoma are attributable to 3 main risk factors: reflux, smoking, and obesity, particularly abdominal obesity. There are few consistently found protective factors: H. pylori, aspirin, NSAID, and in multiple observational studies, statins. It hasn't been associated with alcohol, coffee, or tea. So apart from lending itself to an interesting observation, is there any clinical relevance to what I just said? Well, people have taken those factors and entered them into a calculator that could be applied at population level or primary care patient level, and you can download this calculator, and it builds on several risk factors, all of which I mentioned previously: smoking or not smoking or ex-smoking, NSAID positive or negative, the level of BMI, the frequency of heartburn. The color reflects the risk. So for example, in the red, those are the ones who are current smokers, obese and old, and have a lot of reflux. And at the very bottom here are the ones who do not have reflux, or their reflux is treated and they're young and they're not fat. So the translation of the epidemiology could be in something related to this. Another level of complexity in the epidemiology of adenocarcinoma, the fact that we know what the precursor lesion is, which is Barrett's esophagus. So the question of anything I mentioned, where does the risk factor play a role? Is it in formation of the Barrett's or formation of the cancer, or both? So I'm going to show a couple of slides that look like this: normal to Barrett's, Barrett's to cancer, or normal to cancer. Each arrow would have a number. That number indicates the risk. So for example, male sex, if you look at studies that compare normal to adenocarcinoma, 8 times more likely in men than women. There is studies that show the progression to Barrett's, 3 to 4 times more common in Barrett's, and a smaller magnitude from Barrett's to adenocarcinoma. Apart from just being an exercise of curiosity, the relevance of this is, where do you intervene to prevent? Do you wait for the Barrett's to happen and apply your intervention here, or is it too late unless you intervene before the Barrett's forms? So abdominal obesity, for example, most of the evidence that abdominal obesity works by forming Barrett's, much less in the progression from Barrett's to esophageal adenocarcinoma. In order not to give you vertigo by similar graphs, I just summarized it here. So male sex is mostly associated with Barrett's, very little known about Barrett's to adenocarcinoma. White race is almost completely known to be associated with Barrett's. Nothing is known about progression from BE to adenocarcinoma. Reflux symptoms, it's at the level of Barrett's, and some data about BE to AA. Obesity, mostly Barrett's. Smoking, equally distributed. H. pylori, it's mostly or completely at the level of Barrett's. Genetics work at the level of Barrett's, and then diet, Barrett's. So what am I trying to say here? Most of the risk factors that we know of increase the risk of esophageal adenocarcinoma, at least based on the data that we have, by increasing the risk of Barrett's esophagus. After that, the risk factors may still operate, but it's certainly to a lower extent, and there's much less data. So now I'm going to conclude by this amazing observation. I mean, if you don't remember anything from this talk, you have to remember this: that GERD symptoms, we said, predisposed to Barrett's, and Barrett's predisposed to esophageal adenocarcinoma. There is this remarkable gender, region, race discrepancy. If you talk about GERD symptoms, they're equally distributed between men and women, blacks and whites, Eastern countries and Western countries. When you go to Barrett's esophagus, it tends to be a mostly man disease, mostly seen in Western countries and mostly seen in whites. When you go to esophageal adenocarcinoma, it's virtually, I wouldn't say exclusive, but virtually exclusively a white man disease in Western countries. So these risk factors that I mentioned, can they explain anything of this weird observation? So for the sex disparities in Barrett's, is actually not fully explained by differences in the risk factor prevalence or magnitude associations. So the things that I talked about, obesity, reflux, et cetera, if you adjust for all of them, they don't seem to explain very well the differences why men should be at a much higher risk of adenocarcinoma than women. So GERD symptoms, they're unlikely. Smoking, it's unlikely. Intra-abdominal fat seems to be the closest thing to offer an explanation because men carry more fat in their belly pound for pound than women. When you talk about the race disparity, GERD symptoms are equally distributed between whites and African Americans. Smoking is the same, so this wouldn't explain why whites have more than African Americans. But abdominal obesity seems to offer at least some explanation in that Caucasians and Hispanics seems to carry a lot more weight in their belly as opposed to their buttocks compared to African Americans. How about, I think I mentioned this. So now the second value of epidemiology, I talked about the first one, which is understanding how to put those in risk stratification models. The second one is explaining weird observations. The third one is translating the findings into prevention. Instead of showing multiple studies, I'm just going to show the summary, and that will usher the end of my talk. GERD treatment using medications and surgery and tobacco smoking cessation should be clinically recommended among patients with Barrett's. There's some evidence from observational data that PPI reduced the risk of progression from Barrett's to adenocarcinoma. NSAID seemed to be associated with a reduced risk of EAC, but lack of interventional data prevent the recommendation for using of aspirin or NSAID for the sole purpose of reducing esophageal adenocarcinoma. HRT and statin, there's really not enough to recommend this as an intervention. Although it makes sense, but there's little evidence that weight loss reduces the risk of esophageal adenocarcinoma, or even in interventional data that examined dietary supplements with vitamins and minerals, no evidence shown that it reduces esophageal squamous carcinoma. So at the end, the trends, esophageal adenocarcinoma is rising in several populations, remarkable variations related to region, gender, or race. Remember those circles that I've drawn? The stories behind the trend is increasing chronic GERD, increasing obesity, declining H. pylori. Other risk and protective factors are NSAID, protective, smoking, old age, increase. Seems like most of the risk factors work through promoting the development of Barrett's, and this information can be used for prevention strategies. Thank you very much.